In 1912, a Polish antique collector named Wilfred Voynich found a long-forgotten chest in an Italian library. And inside was a well-preserved manuscript, seemingly from the Middle Ages, with about 240 pages filled with illustrations of plants, stars, people, and animals. But what really set the book apart was its text, which appeared to be written in a totally alien, never-before-seen language. Voynich spent the rest of his life trying and failing to unlock the book's secrets, and to this day, no one has ever been able to decipher its meaning. But now, a century after its rediscovery, a group of scientists might have finally uncovered a convincing explanation for the truth, that it was an elaborate medieval hoax. Although it's usually called the Voynich manuscript, we can now trace the book's ownership back several centuries, possibly from the court of an Austrian emperor to its current home at Yale University. And thanks to carbon dating, we know it was written in the 1400s, likely in Central Europe. But we have no idea what the book says. Despite the letters kinda looking like Latin ones, Voynichese, as it's known, doesn't match any known language, European or otherwise. So, is it even a language? After scientists took interest in deciphering the manuscript, they started using fancy math and linguistics techniques to better understand it. And it turns out that the book seems to follow a well-known law of linguistics called Zipf's Law. The rule says that in any language, the nth most frequent word appears about 1 over n times less frequently than the first most frequent word. So if the most commonly used word in English is the, then the will be used about 100 times as often as the 100th most common word, find, and 1,000 times as often as the 1,000th most common word, entry. And now you know the 1,000th most common word in the English language. Following Zipf's law is a pretty big hint that whatever words the Voynichese language uses do behave like an actual language. And yet, there's also solid reason to believe that the manuscript is really a convincing-looking hoax. But to explain that, we need to understand a bit about information theory. But since all science needs funding, we need to take a quick break first.
Thanks to Brilliant for supporting this episode of SciShow. Brilliant is an online learning platform where you can develop your skills and deepen your knowledge. They've got courses on math, science, data analysis, programming, and more, so you'll never get bored or run out of topics to explore. Whether you're just starting or you're already a pro, Brilliant will have a class that's perfectly designed to build on your skills while still offering you a fun challenge. Their courses are designed to let you play and solve puzzles yourself, keeping you engaged and entertained while you learn. To try Brilliant for free, visit brilliant.org/scishow, scan the QR code on screen, or click the link in the video description. You will also get 20% off an annual premium subscription.
The key idea behind the science of information theory is that some messages have more information in them than others. Like, compare the phrases blah 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 and I like to swim. Both have the same number of characters, but clearly one is more information-rich than the other. Information theory lets us quantify that difference using something called the conditional entropy. That measures how disordered or uncertain the text is. For instance, in English, the letter Q is basically always followed by U. So if you see a Q, you can reliably predict the next letter. It's not surprising to see the U. So the entropy of the U in QU is much lower than the entropy of any other two-letter pair. So you can work out entropy values for every letter in English, or two-letter pair, or three-letter triple, and so on, and you can do the same for Voynichese. And when you do so, what you see is kinda weird. The entropy of pairs of letters in Voynichese is way, way lower than in any known language. Like, you can clearly see it in this graph. I mean, spot the odd one out. So this is kind of a big hint that Voynichese isn't a natural language. It acts like it isn't conveying information. But even more striking evidence that it isn't a real language comes from a 2019 paper. In that work, researchers plotted how similar each pair of Voynichese words is, as a function of how far apart they are in the text. They found that the closer in the text two words are to each other, the more similar they are. This really really isn't how a normal book works. For example, in A Game of Thrones, if the word pair Jon Snow appears on one page, you can expect to see it again nearby. But in the Voynich manuscript, it's as if the words Jan Snow, Don Snow, and Jon Snot are showing up consistently near Jon Snow. And this is happening for like every word. It's hard to imagine how this could happen by accident. It's as contrived as the 20th century American novel Gatsby, where the author deliberately avoided using the letter E. It's even evidence against the idea that the manuscript is written in an encoded language, since encryption tends to destroy correlations, but here we find more correlations than usual. So maybe the text is all just gibberish, except it still follows Zipf's law, and like, look at these pages. They clearly look like actual written words. It's as if it was written to fool you into thinking it was a real language, or at least an encryption of one. So the 2019 paper, building on previous works, described how a medieval writer could have pulled this off, using a basic algorithm. And now we're not talking about some kind of advanced AI giving you video recommendations. This algorithm was a set of instructions simple enough for a medieval scribe to follow while writing on parchment by candlelight. The idea was that the writer would start a page by copying out a line from the previous page, with a few letter changes sprinkled in. Then, line by line, they'd fill the rest of the page with more words by slightly modifying the words already there, or randomly deciding to split or join up words, or add prefixes, and so on. So if the line they took from a previous page was, "Jon Snow went to the wall," they might write the next line as, "Want into Jan Snow, well she," by editing, jumbling, and combining the previous sentence's words. It's kind of like a medieval ChatGPT. The researchers claim to have followed these steps to generate text that follows all the statistical patterns of Voynich's, from Zipf's law to the Jan Snow effect. Now, the researchers weren't saying they'd found the algorithm that made the manuscript, just that they'd found a plausible method that the writer could have used. And of course, the author didn't need to follow any algorithm exactly. They could have mixed things up a bit whenever they felt like it. But we still don't know why someone would do this. I mean, that's kind of a lot of effort for a simple prank, right? Here, the pictures in this book might give us some hints. They are organized into different sections, like the plant pictures seem to mostly occur near each other, as if it's a book with different chapters. So maybe the book was meant to look like it was about alchemy, the mysterious forerunner to chemistry that was very much in vogue at the time. After all, alchemists were infamous for being super secretive about their work. I mean, if you can turn lead into gold, you don't just say so. You make other people work for it. Alchemists often used code words and highly metaphorical illustrations to simultaneously convey and conceal their secrets. So maybe the book was made to trick or fool other alchemists into thinking it had hidden secrets. That could explain why some of the pictures are totally made up plants and animals. Or maybe the writer was a medieval fire festival organizer who wanted to sell the secrets of the philosopher's stone to a gullible rich sucker. Or maybe it was just an artistic exercise by a group of bored monks. I mean, maybe they just didn't have much to do back then. We'll probably never know the full truth about who wrote the manuscript, let alone why. But as sad as it is that it probably doesn't contain lost alchemical secrets, the quest to learn the manuscript's real truth is pretty exciting too.